Good evening. Good evening, St. Peter Missionary Baptist Church family and friends. We're so glad to have all of you on tonight. I'm so glad to see so many of you on today. Hey, Rev Stan, mute yourself, I believe, on your phone. Mute your phone. Rev Stan, we good. So it's good to have everybody on tonight as we are in another expectation moment. I think we are 406 days. And I'm so grateful to see many of y'all face again. I can see a lot of y'all tonight. Hey, everybody, I can see. It's good to see y'all tonight. I'm also want to say I'm so glad. Look, I got all my preachers on here tonight. All the preachers on here, I believe. I look like everybody on here. Thank you, preachers and deaconesses and everybody's on here. And praise team. I see the praise team here. We have talked last week about the necessity of us living by faith in God. We even went on as far as to say that we walk by faith and not by sight. And then last night, we recognized that the need for faithfulness, the need for faithfulness is buried and rooted in the fact that God himself is faithful. We talked about that last night in the book of Deuteronomy. God is faithful. He is a faithful God. Moses said that the Lord is God and he is faithful. If I had been Moses, Reverend Stan, if I said that, I'd have put my the word walked away, because that's all it is. The Lord is God and he is faithful. That's a close right there. And we can rest assured, we can take a position in the fact that God is who he is and he is faithful. But tonight we want to go over here to the 91st Psalm and look at the manifestation of the faithfulness of God in our day-to-day living. I put it like that. Moses said that the Lord is God and he is faithful. And that's true. But the psalmist here in the 91st Psalm says, let me carry a little bit further and show you how that faithfulness looks, how it looks in our day-to-day lives. Because the truth is, all of us who are living in this world today, we're living day by day, trusting in the Lord. And so the author of Psalms 91 says, let me go ahead and break it down for you and show you how it looks as you walk through this world. The 91st Psalm, the author of the 91st Psalm, has always been some debate around it, but we do know it is an inspired word of God. Perhaps it was Moses, because some of the words look like the 90th Psalm, which Moses did write. But nonetheless, whoever wrote it was inspired by God to give us these words as encouragement in our lives. I'm not going to do the two verses, Lord willing, but I want us to look at these verses carefully. Now, we did actually touch on this last summer, but as a refresher, we're going to look at verse 1 until we get to verse 2, which is where, where we get to verse 4, where our context is for tonight. The psalmist begins by making this declaration. And he makes this declaration in the sense that he wants to remind all of God's people of the reality of his statement. He says in verse 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place. That's how he starts this. He is saying to all believers, let's mute the phones over here. He that dwelleth in the secret place. So we know that dwelleth means that a person is not a visitor to a place. He lives in that place. That is where they dwell. That is where they find their comfort, their rest, their relaxation, all that they need. So if I were to say that somebody dwells in I don't know, 1558 Venetia Drive, that's where they find everything they need. Rev Stanley, whatever your address is, wait, that's where you live. That's where you find your temporal needs. The psalmist here is saying that our spiritual needs are met in the secret place of the Most High. In other words, any individual, any person, any child of God, Christian, who says, I'm going to make my spiritual home in the secret place of God, I can expect some things to happen. He says, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High. This dwelling is not a physical thing, but it's a spiritual thing. But it's a deliberate action that each of us as children of God must make. We must decide that where we want to live is in the secret place of the Most High. Who is the Most High? God is the Most High. Where is the secret place? In his presence. How do we get in his presence? Through constantly seeking him, through constantly being in his word, praying, praising him, worshiping him. In other words, if we do this every day, what we'll find ourselves is in that secret place. Why is it secret? Well, it's a secret because everybody can't get there. The person who cannot find themselves seeking God and praying all the time, that's not where they'll dwell. But it's a secret to those, who don't know the Lord, but it's a known fact to those of us who do know the Lord. There was a club when I was younger, it was a frat house, really. And in order to get in, you had to have the code. You know, code was his word. And if you came to the door, just knocked on the door, you couldn't get in because you didn't have the right word. But on the flip side, if you were part of the organization, you could come to the door and you say the word, you knew the word, you say the word, you could come right in and you could stay as long as you wanted to. What I'm saying is, as Christians, we must understand that we have the password to the place, the secret place of the Most High. And in doing so, the password is simply trusting and depending on God, being obedient to God, but also in our constant desire to remain in the secret place, to dwell there, which is a constant state. Listen to this, a constant state of praise, a constant state of prayer, a constant state of worship, and a constant state of studying the word of God, and finally, a constant state of service. Five things, that's the code. Prayer, praise, worship, word, and service. Five things, that's the secret code for us to dwell in the secret place of the Most High. And it's not hard, it's just what we should be doing. But the obvious is, if we dwell in the secret place by doing these things of the Most High, what we'll find ourselves doing is abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. In other words, in dwelling with God, what we will find is the shadow of God that surrounds us. Okay, so think about this. It's hot outside, but you go stand next to a large building. What will you get? First of all, you'll get shade. But let's say it's not hot outside. Let's say that it's a storm outside and it's raining everywhere and you stand next to the building and the building has its cover. What do you be protected from? The elements. What we must understand is we constantly find ourselves praying, praising, worshiping, studying, and serving. What we'll find ourselves doing is that we'll be protected from the elements of spiritual warfare. And we'll also find ourselves comforted by the protection that God provides. Many people in church today, we find ourselves wanting to dart out in the elements on our own and not trust God. We find ourselves wanting to ourselves. And as a result, what we find out is we're subject the give and the take of the ins and outs of the world. I'm not saying as we dwell in the secret place of the Most High, I'm saying as we dwell in the secret place of the Most High, we'll be protected in all that happens to us. In other words, dwelling in the secret place of the Most High will put us in a position where we can fully experience all of God's protection and all of his power over us so that what is taking place around us will not affect us. That's what the psalmist says in verse 1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. He moves on to say, and now he's giving his, how would I say, his endorsement. Verse 2, I will say of the Lord, he said, I will say, because of my experience, because of what I've seen, that the Lord is my refuge and my fortress. He says, I will say without a doubt, as I have dwelt in the secret place of the Most High, as I have abided in the shadow of the Almighty, what I found is that the Lord is my refuge and my fortress. Refuge has always been known as a place that one could hide in times of trouble. A fortress was a place where a person could stay when enemies were attacking. A fortress was a place that was expected. Listen to this. A fortress was a place that was expected to have to deal and contend with enemy attack. But the fortress is also known as a safe place to be when the enemy attacks. Now, keeping that concept in mind, the psalmist says, as we dwell in the secret place of the Most High, as we abide under the shadow of the Almighty, we will find out that God is a refuge. He is a place that we can hide. He is a hide. And it's not a runaway and hide. It's just a place where we can go to find the comfort and the protection of God. We'll get the comfort in a minute. And then he says, it is my fortress. As we live in this world, we are fully aware. Let me say this. We are fully aware that we are in enemy territory. How many know we live in this world, we're in enemy territory? How many know we're in enemy territory? We are children of God on our way home. Heaven is our home. So right now, and Peter said it real good. Peter said we're sojourners. We're here in this world, but we're sojourners. We're on our way through this world. Now understand that we're always subject to enemy attack. Always. But here's what the psalmist said. I know that the enemy is out there looking for me, attacking me, trying to attack me. But I do know that as long as I dwell in the secret place of the Most High, and as long as I have the benefit of abiding under his shadow, not only will I have refuge, but God himself will be my fortress. He will protect me. Yes, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. But I'm going to take it a step further. When we are in that place of God, that's where we are when we're safe, because God will provide a rampart for us, a standard. And not only will God protect us, but God will fight battles for us. I wish I could do some interviewing of the Old Testament, some of the kings of the Old Testament who watched what God, which I talked to David and said, David, tell me what happened when God told you to come behind the mulberry bush. And I believe David would say, when I went behind the mulberry bush, God told me to wait. And when I waited, I saw God defeat the enemy. Same thing with Jehoshaphat. The people of God in First Chronicles didn't have to fight. All they had to do was watch God fight the battle. when the people of Israel came into the promised land. They didn't have to fight. They just had to walk. What I want us to understand in verse 2 is that as we find ourselves constantly in the presence of God through our prayer, praise, worship, service, and study, we will find ourselves being behind in within the fortress of the protection of God, and also in a place where God will fight our battles for us. I want us to understand that some of us try to fight battles that we ain't supposed to fight. What does the Bible say? The battle is whose? It's not ours. It's the Lord's. And so as long as we are in a place where we think we got to have ourselves, we're going to find ourselves always struggling. But when we find out and realize that the solution to our problems is not to fight, not to struggle, not to strain, not to strive, but instead to serve God. I want to make it as clear as possible. When trouble comes, study. When trouble comes, praise. When trouble comes, pray. When trouble comes, worship. And when study comes, serve. And you'll find out that God's got it all under control. He's got the enemy at bay. He will attack the enemy when it's his time, and he will provide a refuge. I can almost hear the psalmist getting excited now. Verse 3, he says, surely, as in, I'm convinced without a doubt that God, verse 3, the same God who I'm dwelling with under his secret, in his secret place and under his shadow, the same God who is my refuge and my fortress, the same God that I have determined I will trust in him. That's the key element. That's the key to it right there. That's what turns this thing on. In him will I trust. Who you going to trust, psalmist? God. Who you going to trust, St. Peter? God. We're going to trust him. And when we trust him, what we'll do is come to surely. That means when you trust God, it becomes certain to us what God is capable of doing. When you trust him, see, if you don't trust him, you can't be sure what God would do. When you trust him, you find out what he is certainly capable of doing. Surely, the psalmist said, he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler. I painted this picture before, but let me see if I can paint again. The fowler, that's the person who hunted for birds. Some people in the Old Testament hunted for birds for sport, some hunted for food, some hunted to get capture the birds so they could get eggs. It was always a reason for the fowler. The fowler, that was a job, that was a career, a fowler, a person who was able to know where to cast the nets and when to cast the nets and how to catch the birds. The fowler was very sneaky. The fowler wouldn't walk around with nets over his shoulders. The fowler would just put the net someplace or throw the net someplace to capture the birds. Here's the truth. Satan is the same way. Satan seeks to trap us. How many know that? He seeks to catch us, to capture us, to get us in a situation where we can't get out of. But the psalmist says that the Lord will deliver us from the snare of the fowler. That means that Satan may be standing ready to trap us, but guess what? God will deliver us. He will tell us, fly that way, or fly that way, or go this way, or go that way. Why? Because we have put our faith and trust in him, because we're in his holy place and we are under his shadow, and we find that he's our refuge and our fortress. Then verse 3 lets us know that we'll also find out he's our deliverer. And not only that, he will also deliver us from the noisome pestilence. So the noisome pestilence, the reason why the birds would fly, how the fowler would catch them, they make noise. Just like if you go duck hunting now, normally a duck hunter would have a dog, and the dog would run into the woods or wherever the ducks are. I guess it's the reeds, or kind of a wetland. And all of a sudden, the barking of the dogs would cause the birds to do what? Take off flying. Well, when they would take off flying, what would the bird hunter do? The bird hunter would shoot the birds because they left their safe place. That's what would happen. The bird hunter would send the dog in there to create noise, and that noise would create an environment or an atmosphere where the bird had to flee. In our lives, let me slow this down for a minute. In our lives, there's sometimes when we want to run, we want to get away, we want to quit. And I had this conversation with somebody the other day. I admire people who go through a lot in the church and then who decide, I'm going to stay with the Lord. I hear, and it's very disturbing sometimes to hear about people who God has blessed and gifted, and they get mad at one somebody, and they want to take off running, go somewhere else. They want to go to another church or want to quit on God. Heard somebody the other day, well, you know, the church made me sick, and I don't want to be a part of church no more. And many people take it further than that. They say, I'm going to leave the shit with God. I'm going to turn my back on God because I'm sick of those folk. And I always have a practical question to ask folk. I don't know nobody ever quit their job because somebody made them mad. You just stay on your job because you need shit. Well, let me tell you, and I heard somebody say, I stay on the job and I need benefits. Well, I told him, I said, you need to stay with the Lord because you need benefits as well. You need some spiritual benefits and the blessing to come from God. But let me talk about this noise and fowler. Sometimes the enemy tries to get us to run when there ain't no reason to run. Sometimes he wants us to leave our place out in the secret place of the Most High, under the shadows of Almighty, where God is our refuge and our fortress. The enemy wants us to run so that he can do what? Pick us off. But here's what the Bible says, that God will deliver us from that. That means when the enemy is raging and raving and somebody's in your ear and yelling and screaming and mad, and you're mad at them and they're mad at you and they're yelling at them and you want to disconnect, here's what God will do. God will close your ears. Has anybody ever been in a situation where God caused you not to hear what folk were saying? I've been there. Has anybody been in a situation where God caused you not to hear the doubts of people around you? It may have been somebody. But this is what the Bible says here, that God will deliver us. And that means that God will take us a different direction. He will take us a different direction. He will deliver us from the snare of the fowler. He will keep us from getting picked off by the enemy's darts. That's what he'll do. That's what God will do. When? When we dwell in the secret place of the Most High and we abide under the shadow of the Almighty. When we find out he is our refuge and our fortress and our deliverer from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. Look at verse 4. He shall cover thee with his feathers. Now we look at a relationship. We see God's protection. We see God's deliverance. We see how God is able to do these things. But not only is God protecting us, but God is also he is a comfort to us. He shall cover thee with his feathers. Y'all know what I'm talking about. If you ever seen a bird, and I'm actually thinking very seriously about getting one of those bird things in my backyard. I like to watch birds. There's a cardinal that comes to visit me every morning right about breakfast time. It's a nice little red bird. And I love to see that bird. And I'm ready for that bird to have some little chicklets so I can see how it works. But I picture in my mind a bird, a mother bird, does what? She spreads her wings and does what? Covers those little birds. When it's raining, they ain't got to worry about it because mama's wings got them. When the wind blowing, they got to worry about it. When animals come around, and predators come around, the mother bird covers the birds. That's out of the relationship between the mother bird and her little chickens, her little hen, the birds. This is what God does for us. God covers us with his feathers. His powerful provision and protection is predicated upon the relationship that we have with him, comma. The relationship that we have with God was initiated by God himself. We're saved today because God so loved the world. We're not saved today because we so love God. That's what the Bible said. Yeah, the Bible said, say God so loved the world. It didn't say for Thomas so loved God. It said for God so loved the world. It didn't say because Stanley loved God so much. No, it's because God loves Stanley. For God so loved, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Now, in that covenant, we see the care and the concern and the passion of God. So much so that when we're in trouble, we feel and find that his wings, and he covers us. That when we are, how many of us have had a hard day, you want to cry, but all of a sudden you felt comfort. You know who that came from? That was just God. That was him putting his feathers over you. How many had looked like some nights you just couldn't go to sleep, you were tossing and turning, and you just called on the Lord, and all of a sudden, sleep came. You know what that was? That was him putting his feathers on you, just wrapping you in his feathers, and sometimes God might rock you when he got his feathers rained. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. The psalmist said, when I feel the presence of the Lord around me, he said, I lean back and go to sleep. He said, I trust him. There have been many times, I know I'm not the only one, there have been many times we've had situation alive that caused us not to sleep. That many times, how many times? Some of us ain't felt good at night. But when we called on the name of the Lord, I got to tell y'all, I know y'all tired of me telling stories. I'm going to give me one more. When there were some nights when I, early on in my sickness, I'd be so sick, and I couldn't get comfortable nowhere in that bed, because then I found out later it was because fluid was around my heart and lungs. But some nights, it wasn't no pill that would work. Wasn't no inhaler. Nothing would work. And I said, Lord, let me get some sleep. Lord, just give me rest. And it looked like before I could say it good, I'd be asleep. As I called on the Lord, it's like as the prayer was going up, he was reaching down. That was his feathers. That wasn't number his feathers covering me. And I decided about 3 or 4 days in, I said, you know what? I'm going to stop taking that pain. I'm just going to call the Lord. And every night, I used to get excited about waiting on God putting me to sleep. I was excited about it. Now, I feel worse than I did yesterday. Let me call on the Lord and watch him. That's what the psalmist said right here. Under his feathers, he says, will I trust? He said, under his wings shall thy trust. When you get into a place where God is covering you, you get into a place where you're comfortable just trusting God. Before sleep even get, you ain't worried about sleep that night because you know that his feathers, his presence, his power, his coverage is all you need. But this is where I want to go. This is where I'm trying to get to right here. Verse 4, his truth. Now, in your NIV version, it'll say faithful. So truth and faithfulness go together. I understand, Rev. Stan, but finally I realized that God's faithfulness is his truth. And because he's the truth, that's his faithfulness. In other words, we can depend on God. We talked about that earlier today. His dependability is based upon the fact that he is and does what he says he's going to do. That's why we can depend on God. Because when God makes a promise, what happens? It comes to pass. And so in this verse 4, he says, not only will God cover us with his feathers, not only will we trust under his wings, but I want to point out before I hit that already in these four verses, we've seen that word trust twice. In verse 2, the psalmist said, I will trust. In verse 4, he said, under his wings shalt thou trust. In verse 2, he's saying he trusts. In verse 4, he's challenged us to trust God. Now, in looking at that, what the next thing he says is his truth. Now, I want to look at this activation here. We start off in the secret place of the Most High, dwelling there. How we dwell? Prayer, praise, worship, study, and service. That's how we get there. That's how we stay there. All right? When that happens, then we can abide under the shadow of the Almighty. All right? When that happens, we realize that he is our refuge and he is our fortress and he is our God, our God. And because of that, we trust him. Then we find out that, and we're certain now, verse 3, that he would deliver us from the snare of the fowl and from the noise and pestilence. But not only that, but we realize that he said he would cover us with his feathers. And then when we're there, we'll trust in him under his wings. But then getting there, he says, his truth, his faithfulness shall be thy shield and buckler. Now, I'm going to slow down. Let me see how much time I got. I think I got enough time without going over. Shield and buckler. A shield was obviously an instrument that was utilized by the soldier to protect them from a frontal assault by the enemy. That's what a shield was. A shield was something that could be carried by the soldier. So that whatever the enemy was coming with them, they could protect them. If an enemy was lunging them with a sword, they could protect themselves. If an enemy was shooting darts, they could protect themselves. Whatever the enemy tried, even if the enemy tried to bum rush and run into them, they could thrust their shield out and provide a buffer between them. But look at what the psalmist says. The psalmist says that God's faithfulness, his truth, shall be our shield. What does that mean? That means that when we trust God and know that he is faithful, we trust in him and we know he is faithful, that means that in that calculation, in that algorithm, in that chemical spiritual response, we know that through our trust combined with the faithfulness of God, God is able to protect us from anything that will, listen to this, come our way. Y'all got me? Whatever will come our way, our trusting him combined with his faithfulness will be our protection. Sometimes we worry about what's going to come our way. But as we trust God, and because God is being faithful, we have a shield of protection that will protect us from whatever the enemy throws our way, period. So if you sometimes say you're biting your nails, I don't know what's going to happen. Trust God because he's faithful. And because he's faithful, as we trust him, we'll find the protection that we can only find in him. What we realize is that there's no other person, no other situation, no other body that can protect us. You can trust your friends all day long, but unfortunately, we're fat. We are frail, and we can't protect you. We want to sometimes, but we can't. Sometimes people don't even want to. But God wants to protect us, and God can protect us. So as we trust God, and his faithfulness means that we have the protection. Thank you, Sister. I saw what you put down there. We have the protection that we need from any enemy attack. But then look at this last part. I'm going to let you go now. His truth shall be thy shield. And he says, and buckler. The buckler was what held the soldier's equipment together. The soldier had a breastplate, had a backplate, and it was held together by this belt. And this belt caused not only the soldier to be protected on their body, but it also held everything together so they could move forward. Let me say it again. The buckler was a belt that, listen to this, held everything together to allow the soldier to be able to be protected from the front attack and also from a rear attack, but also it allowed the soldier to be able to move, because if they didn't have this belt on, they'd have one hand carrying the shield and one hand holding everything else up. Y'all know, if anybody, if a man ever had on a pair of pants that were too big and you had your belt on, you had to carry, you had to have at least one hand holding your pants up. That's what it was like not to have a belt when you were a soldier. But the Bible says here that God's faithfulness, his truth, is our shield and also our buckler, meaning that not only is God's, that as we trust God, that he'll protect us. Listen to this. As we trust God, he'll hold it all together. He'll hold it all together. He'll give us protection from the front. He'll give us protection from the back. And he'll allow us to keep moving forward. There's so many times that children of God, we want to back up. Don't back up. Just trust God, and his truth will hold it all together. You may be falling apart, but if you trust God, he'll do what? He'll hold. Somebody say that with me. He'll hold it all together. He'll hold it all together. I'm glad that we serve a God who is so faithful. We've fallen apart. He'll hold it all together. And he'll keep us in a place where we can continue to walk and press toward the high mark of the calling in Christ Jesus. We need to trust him because he is faithful. And when we find, when we realize that we can trust him, we realize that he will protect us from enemy attack, and he'll hold it all together. I'm going to stop tonight right here. I got it at 7:30. I got it at 7:30. I don't know extra time tomorrow. But I want us to remember God's faithful. That's what I want us to remember. So faith, our faith, and God's faithfulness equals protection and equals God holding it all together. I love y'all tonight, and I can't wait to see y'all tomorrow night. Thank you, all of you all who are on the Zoom line and the phone line. Let us pray. God, in Jesus' name, we just say thank you for another half hour of being in your word in this expectation moment. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this 94th Psalm. We thank you for verses 1-4. And we thank you, Lord, for again reminding us that you alone, your faithfulness, Lord, is all that we need as we trust you. That we don't have to find any ancillary protection. But as we trust you, your faithfulness will provide all that we need. You are our refuge and you are our fortress. You are, Lord, you will deliver us from the snare fowler and the noisome pestilence. You are our fortune deliverer. And Lord, we let us, this group of people here on this line tonight, decide that we want to dwell with you in your secret place and under your shadow, because you are, in fact, Almighty God. I pray, God, for every household tonight that's represented. I pray for every believer that's represented. I pray for every family that is represented. And I pray, God, that you let your word get in our hands and feet, that we can serve you. Let your word get in our minds so that our minds will be protected. Let your word get in our ears so that we can hear your word ringing above all else. All the noise and the pestilence out there in the world, help us to hear your word. And I pray, God, that your word will get in our hearts, that our inner man may be strengthened so that we can stand. And after everything else, just keep on standing. But God, I ask again that you'd help your word to get in our, on our lips, our tongues, our vocal cords, our lungs, and our throat, that we can declare that you are a faithful God to this world, to each other, and to ourselves. God, we sure love you, and we sure do thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless you, phone line. Hold on, Zoom.